Hello, I'm Richard Ager. Welcome to New Hampshire Outlook. After more than a year of often bitter debate, the Congress has passed a health reform bill that will cover all Americans.
For the families in New Hampshire and across America, I vote yes for you.
It was a vote that nearly didn't happen, as both parties scrambled to keep their representatives in line in the House for a partisan vote. The Republicans all voted no, as promised.
Mr. Speaker, I vote no.
The Democrats managed to keep enough members from straying and ended with a 7-vote margin.
The motion to concur in the Senate amendment is adopted.
And we have now just enshrined, as soon as I sign this bill, the core principle that everybody should have some basic security when it comes to their health care. And it is an extraordinary achievement that has happened because of all of you and all the advocates all across the country. So thank you. Thank you. God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America.
President Obama signed the bill letter by letter so that each commemorative pen used would truly be part of history. Beside him, 11-year-old Marcellus Owens, who lost his mother to an illness. She had no insurance, and Marcellus told her story across the country during the campaign for this bill.
We are done.
And joining me at the State Library in Concord, we have Charlie Arlinghouse, president of the Josiah Bartlett Center for Public Policy, and Ned Helms, director of the New Hampshire Institute for Health Policy and Practice. Welcome, gentlemen.
It's nice to be with you.
Thanks.
Well, the president said this is what change looks like, a historic day. Charlie, do you agree?
Well, it was certainly, yes, it was a historic day, and this is what change looks like. Some of us like that change. Some of us, let's just say me, don't like that change as much. But it's hard to deny that it was historic, like many mistakes are.
Well, how substantive is this change?
I think it's a big change, and a very big change. I think no one would argue that the healthcare system needed to be addressed. It is a system that consumes twice as much as any other industrialized country, leaves 20% of the people out, and doesn't produce fabulous outcomes. What this did, in addition to the particulars of the bill, is to give us a framework for developing our healthcare system over the next 15 years. And absent that framework, we would have just gone off in who knows what direction, but this will allow us to focus not only on insurance, but coverage and on the way care is delivered. So I think it was important in terms of giving us a framework for moving forward.
Well, let's take a look at some of the highlights of the package, because some parts kick in before others do. But when the president signed that bill on Tuesday, what changed immediately?
Well, I mean, there are a couple things. The ability of the states to act on their own. I mean, up until today, we'd viewed the system of regulating health insurance as a state-by-state affair, where what New Jersey does is not what New Hampshire has to do, what Nebraska does is not necessarily what Texas does. And that's going to change. But most of the changes are being phased in slowly over time. I mean, at the end of the day, everybody is going to be required as a condition of living, or I was going to say citizenship, but even non-citizens, I guess, of purchasing an insurance policy, so you can no longer not have one. But that will be phased in over time, and we will start to see some of the subsidies kick in, and some of the increased Medicaid requirements kick in. I mean, let's remember, in theory, if you look at the healthcare portions of the bill, and this bill has a lot of portions in it that aren't healthcare to try to make the numbers work better. But the healthcare portions of the bill, the big theory behind it is, let's try and take the 30 or 40 million people who do not have insurance today, whatever that number actually is, and cover them. And the vast majority of them are going to be covered essentially through an expansion of Medicaid. And most of the other provisions of the bill are ways to finance that expansion of Medicaid and to make it easier.
So would you say, in essence, this is something as profound as rewriting the social contract for this country?
I wouldn't. I think that there are directions they could have taken with the bill where you could say it was rewriting a social contract. I think what happened
is... There's now a right to coverage which did not exist before, though.
There's a government program for coverage. And, you know, when we say something is a right, you know, what kind of right are you talking about? You have a right under the law currently to have this. That's not the same thing as something like, say, the right to free speech which is a which is a negative right. You don't have a right to something. You have a right not to be prohibited from doing something. And I think it's not so profound as that. This is not a constitutional change. It is a legal change. It is a legal change in the way Medicaid, essentially, is administered. There are changes that could have been made to healthcare and that were considered to be made in healthcare that I think would have been incredibly profound and therefore much more controversial. And I think that that this is not one of them. It is, at best, probably a compromise. I said to friends of mine who can't stand the bill, and I'm not a fan of it either, I said, you know, at the end of the day, it could have been a lot worse.
Well, you know, Ned, I just in terms of, you know, man on the street kind of thing, I think a lot of people are expressing relief.
I think so. This is not a conversation that's been taking place since Barack Obama was elected president. This is a conversation that's been going on, as we've heard, since Teddy Roosevelt was the president. We are the last industrialized nation on the face of the earth to say that everyone will have health care as a right. But I think going back to your original question of what will change immediately, there will be small businesses in the state of New Hampshire who will get a 35% tax deduction on the insurance coverage that they now offer to if they offer to their employees. There are going to be kids who will not be able to be excluded within 6 months for having pre-existing conditions. There are going to be seniors who are facing the donut hole, and the donut hole starts its phasing out this year. It doesn't complete it until 2019, as I recall. But, you know, it's a $500 is $500 when you're on a retirement income. So there were a series of things there. There's also a series of things that happened that are tremendously important that didn't get the attention. There are a lot of dollars directed to our community health centers. We have community health centers all over this state. And increasingly, they have found not that they're dealing with Medicaid population, but the uninsured population. And we just had a study done by some folks from Harvard on the community health centers in our state that was paid for by the Endowment for Health that showed that those centers are in extraordinarily fragile financial shape. I happen to serve on the advisory board of Bi-State Primary Care, and this will be tremendously important for parts of our state where access to care, primary care, was hanging by a thread.
Well, we're adding tens of millions of uninsured now into the plan for coverage. I mean, do we even have the facilities, the doctors, for example, the primary doctors, to handle that?
Well,
or are we setting ourselves up for...
Charlie and I have chatted about this on a couple of different occasions. And one of the things that I think is important is that the folks who looked at this bill watched the Massachusetts experience. There's a healthcare triangle that everybody talks about: access, cost, and quality. And you can't touch one without affecting the others. And Massachusetts said, let everybody in, i.e., access. And what happened was, in terms of quality, they discovered they let everybody in, but there weren't enough primary care practitioners to take care of them, and costs exploded. And so you see the door really start to open up in 2014, but between now and 2014, a lot of dollars in primary care education, and interestingly enough, we had the highest acceptance rates of doctors in residency programs for primary care, for family practice, in the history of this country this year. There's starting to be more of a focus. So by the time that hits, hopefully we won't have satisfied our need for primary care, but we move in that direction. And I think that's what's part of the thing that's been overlooked about the bill that I think is a very strong part of it.
You know, Charlie, I know you've mentioned that you're not a big fan of this bill, but when you look at the fact that within 6 months, lifetime limits will be outlawed, there'll be no more canceling policies, you know, midway through, and there'll be no more denial of coverage for children with pre-existing conditions. I don't know, but it sounds to me like opposing those kinds of changes, not to get political for the moment, but are not a winning formula for endearing yourselves to the greater population.
At the end of the day, either side can take one or two provisions of the bill and pick it out and say, this is a wonderful thing, therefore the rest of the bill must be passed too, or this is a terrible thing, therefore the rest of the bill must be defeated too. And I think that that's that's a fairly cynical approach to both politics and, more importantly, to public policy. Almost everything that passed has things in it that we think are noble and things in it that we think are probably a little bit less than noble.
But we never seem to be able to get past them before.
I'm not sure we're going to get past them this time. And one of the big problems with the bill is it is a financial house of cards, and it is very difficult to sustain. There are, you know, by one measurement, if you include all of the non-healthcare things that are in the bill in the financial calculus, You can say that the bill is paid for, but in fact, you know, that's costing the bill at roughly $900 billion, when most of the provisions don't take effect during the first 5 years. When the bill is fully phased in, the first 10 years of the bill as fully phased in are estimated to cost around $2.5 trillion. It doesn't raise $2.5 trillion. So the question is, how do you get there? One of the ways they get there is by cutting $500 billion out of Medicare. Now, I don't think, no one I know thinks that's going to be easy. Very few people I know think it's likely to happen. In addition to that, there is a $200 to $300 billion thing called a doctor fix. If we, the way the Medicare law is currently written, we would ratchet down payments to doctors, and the cost of that is about $200 billion. That has been postponed every year for the last, I think it's 7 years, something like that. And if we don't postpone it, then it will help pay for this bill.
Well, it sounds like each of those particular issues needs to be separated out.
And I think I think they're not going to be.
See, Charlie used an important phrase, which was financial house of cards. And the reality is our healthcare system was a financial house of cards, and it was tumbling down. The pillars of the healthcare system were eroding. The health of our population was eroding. The differential between Medicare and Medicaid payments and what was really what they really covered was eroding things.
When you saw premiums increase by 39%,
premiums going up 40%, you see businesses dropping coverage. You see healthcare costs escalating way more than the gross domestic product. And so there was a financial house of cards. There is no question. I mean, I said the other day, this is not the end. Ah, good, we've passed healthcare, it's over. What we've done is we've created the framework, as I said before, for the coming years. It will demand of us that we continue to be as serious and earnest about the implementation of this legislation as we have been in the passing of it. I do think, however, that it strengthens our financial future as it relates to health care rather than weakens it.
To take a system, I think everybody is concerned, Ned's absolutely right, that everybody's concerned about Medicare and Medicaid reimbursement rates. I mean, one of the ways we finance the government government insurance, if you want to call it that, Medicaid, Medicare, is by underpaying. You know, the what it actually costs to go to a doctor, we don't pay that amount, and somebody else has to make up the bill. We've talked before about how hospitals in New Hampshire, essentially half their payments are from private insurance, and those are above average. Half their payments are from Medicare and Medicaid, and if they have too many, they can't stay in business. And it just seems to me that if you're really concerned about that, then if you were to cut $500 billion out of that system that you think is already underpaid, and you were to cut $200 billion out of the doctor payments, which are clearly underpaid, and you're to add perhaps tens of millions of people into the Medicaid system, which massively underpays people, and can only be supported if there's a similar number of private insurers, that I don't see how that's sustainable.
Well, let's look at two sort of classes of people, if you will. Mm-hmm. We have a few minutes left here. Now that this has passed, let's look at first those who are fairly satisfied with their policies now, mm-hmm. and second, those who have not been able to get coverage. Mm-hmm. Are both of those classes more or less happy?
Yeah, I think they will be, because if you have insurance coverage now, you continue to keep it. And if you should lose your job, if you should find out that you're ill and you read the fine print and you find out that, this condition isn't covered, or if you have annual or lifetime limits, those things are going to go away. We are going to have insurance that is more robust, is fuller. If you don't have access to it, we begin to open that up over time, starting in 2014, and you move in through the exchanges. And I think what that does is move us forward to a
system. Now, we should say the exchanges, that's where you would go to either get a policy or to replace a policy.
If you don't get one through your company, you can go to the exchange, and it's simply a place where you could go and pick out one of the private offerings that would be at various levels. Here's the important thing, and I think Charlie's absolutely right, that we were on a, we were in a financial going over the cliff mode. But part of that was because of the primary conventions of the financial system, which was fee for service. It's basically 18% of our gross domestic product based on piecework. And now The changes in reimbursement, which will be contemplated in this bill, is not paying per procedure or per process, but looking at more creative ways to pay for outcomes. And some of the best performing systems in our country have really moved well down the track on this. And what we're going to try and do is to replicate best performing systems across the board. The reason that wouldn't have worked before is because unless you take a comprehensive approach to look at cost, access, and quality together, you can't get to the end.
Well, we have about a minute and a half here. And Charlie, what I guess as we look ahead now that this has become law, do you think that the opposition to this point, that the Republicans in particular, will try to work to help make this work, to help improve it? Because what we've heard so far is that they're going to keep fighting it on both the national, with Judge Gregg leading the fight in the Senate, and here on the state level.
I mean, it seems to me that if you think this is a bad thing, that you should, in fact, be in favor of repealing it. One of my primary criticisms of politics as it is exercised today is that people who are against something are unwilling to say they're against something. If you're against it, say you're against it. If you're really against it, you should want to repeal it. I think it's important, though, for anybody who wants to repeal this, that they not give up the idea that some reform is absolutely unequivocally necessary. So you can repeal it, but you must reform as well. You have to put something else in place instead of
the system. Well, why haven't they come out and said we're also against pre-existing conditions?
what they've talked about are different ways to deal with all of these different issues. And I mean, everybody's against pre-existing conditions. I wish none of your conditions pre-existed. Mm-hmm. I wish none of my conditions pre-existed. But what they're trying to do is come up with not just sophistry, but an actual program. And you know, we get at what Ned said, and I would be much more confident if Ned had designed this plan, because everything he talks about moving away from fee for service and replicating systems like Geisinger, Intermountain Health, or the Mayo Clinic systems, is absolutely right. But what we know from this bill is that it takes the opposite approach. They're going to cut the portion of Medicare that attempted to do that,
and
which is Medicare Advantage.
I'm afraid
we need a second show because I'd like to rebut that, but we don't have.
I will welcome both of you back probably pretty soon. For now, that is the last.
We'd
word
be delighted
for
to
you,
come
Charlie.
Back.
Thank you so much, Ned Hills, Charlie Arnhouse.
Next,
a high-profile visit to the state. David Petraeus became known as the general who took command of the U.S. and Allied forces in Iraq in 2007 and launched the surge. That increase in the U.S. military presence there is widely credited for bringing a measure of stability to the region and making possible the current measured withdrawal of troops from the area. General Petraeus visited the Institute of Politics at St. Anselm's College this week. He spoke about Iraq, Afghanistan, the surge, and the guiding philosophy behind it.
The most important surge in Iraq was a surge of ideas. Among those big ideas, for example, was secure the population. Do it by living with the people. Live our values is a hugely important one. Be first with the truth. Support reconciliation, and on and on. Well, the live our values is caught up in the whole interrogation issue. And I would argue there are two reasons to live your values. First of all, you know, decades, for centuries, great patriots from our country have fought to preserve and protect those values. They're the result of enormous intellectual debate and discussion. And in a sense, it's the right thing to do.
And joining me to talk about the visit by General Petraeus, I have Bill Martell. He is Associate Professor of International Security Studies at the Fletcher School, Tufts University. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you, Richard. It's a pleasure.
Well, as we've seen, the surge was a turning point, obviously. Where might we be now, do you think, without General Petraeus having been in charge?
I think, Richard, the consensus view within the national security foreign policy community is General Petraeus is the architect of what I think people are describing now as the general pattern of success in Iraq, and I think also with a direction of success in Afghanistan. And at the time that he took over and became really the guy in charge of forces within Iraq, at the time of the surge, before the surge actually, I think most people think this guy snatched victory from the jaws of defeat. Events, conditions in Iraq were disintegrating. And he came in as the architect of something called COIN, COIN, counterinsurgency strategy, and said, we need to get back to basics, live among the population, build security for the people, and only then can we begin to establish some degree of success in Iraq. One of his famous quotes is, money is ammunition. Building projects, helping the local population, having our forces live within the local population, were absolutely instrumental in changing conditions in Iraq that I think in 06, 2006 and into early 07, the surge, most people believed Iraq was going over the cliff into a sectarian civil war.
You know, he talked a lot about the importance of living our values, even
yes.
as an occupying force, and the cost if we don't. And he says that's why he, to this day, wants to close Gitmo, the Guantanamo Bay prison, because he says it is a superb facility, but it is tainted by what went on there, and the United States must divest itself of that for that reason.
His argument is, and it's a contentious argument, there's a lot of different views in this, is that when you have a places like Gitmo, and he also mentioned the prison Abu Ghraib in Iraq, he said these taint the image of the people in that part of the world toward the United States. Now the counter argument, and I'm supportive of what he's arguing, is that when you move in that direction, it makes it harder to operate the way classic military forces like to operate. But his emphasis on counterinsurgency strategy totally changed the dynamic, the logic, the thinking within both our government, at our highest levels in government, and in the military on what we have to do to achieve success. And victory, actually, is the word in Iraq.
Well, talk a little bit about that. I mean, how did he arrange for his troops to actually live with the population? In other words, get closer to them.
What had happened from the time of the invasion in 2003 until Iraq really began to become unglued in 06, and clearly by 07 it was almost in civil war. We had these elaborate, enormous bases that we established, and people, American forces, would live at the base at night, and then go out and go to various communities and provide assistance and support the local population. But they went home at night. And so what the quote bad guys, the insurgents, the Ba'athists, others would do is go back to the populations at night when the Americans are gone, terrorize, kill, torture people. So what he said is American forces will live in the community. They will live there 24/7 so that people in the community in Baghdad, among other places, and all of the communities in Iraq, know that American forces and coalition forces are there to protect them, and therefore the insurgents and others can't come in at night and torture people. It took 4, 5, 6 months. This began in late 06, very beginning of 07. By the fall of 07, and he showed a chart, if you remember last night in the talk, showing the number of casualties, the
yes,
number of attacks going dramatically down. So this was the fundamental issue that changed our ability and the international community's ability to help Iraq move from the abyss of civil war into the state where they are now, which is, I think, most people think a much better place to be.
You know, I also at the news conference asked General Petraeus about the don't ask, don't tell
yes.
policy, which is what currently, as it's written, keeps gays and lesbians out of or hidden in the armed forces. So here's his take on that.
The time has come to consider if the change should be made, but it should be done in a sensible and thoughtful and deliberate manner that has to include, I think, this review being conducted, because the review is what will identify the views in the force in an objective and rigorous manner. What we have are a lot of unofficial results. We have our own personal views, our thoughts, and so forth, but we need to have something that is, again, more granular and again, objective than that.
So what do you think about his response?
I thought his response was very interesting and very effective. And what he basically said in so many words is that the way to make that decision is to do analysis. What he didn't say, but what I heard him say, was let the people in the military evaluate this and understand exactly what's required, what steps we need to take, and to do this right. And I think that's reminiscent of the arguments that General Colin Powell, among others, have made, which is find out if this is something that the military can live with, that they can make whatever changes in policy they need to make this work effectively for the United States. So I thought his response was very interesting, and I suspect, though I don't think he was trying to make a policy statement, illustrative of a profound, significant shift in the debate in American society about the don't ask, don't tell.
Well, certainly he did concede that, you know, a public opinion has changed, and
yes.
polls show that, obviously, since the original policy was first promulgated back in 1993, and I guess that ties in with his living our values.
It sure does, and I think what's very interesting and very effective about his presentations is saying to people that I think people have a sense that military people will say, here's the way to fight and win wars, and it has a very military, classic military sense. What he's saying is a much bigger argument, which is we have to live our values, we have to do, what he really says is do the right thing, whether it's in Iraq, whether it's don't ask, don't tell, do the right thing and do so in a measured, coherent fashion. And I think that's why he's very effective in these kinds of public presentations.
Kind of like your mom, always be honest.
Yeah, don't lie.
You know, he also took pains to deny that this was in any way a political visit, which suspicions always arise when a prominent figure comes here. But he said, look, he's a resident, actually, officially of New Hampshire. He has New Hampshire plates. And perhaps this is just as well, not running for office, because he also made it clear he's a lifelong New York Yankees fan.
That's right. And that was really one of the interesting moments in the room. There was no booing, but you could tell everybody was very much enjoying
some intake of breath, I would say.
I think so. I took him his word when he said that it's the Sherman-esque no, and he said, I've said no so many times, and then there's the classic response, what's unclear about no? I took him his word. I didn't sense that there was any dissimulation going on or any.
Yeah, well, then my last question to you, Bill, but don't you think he'd be a good candidate?
I think there are lots of people to be a good candidate, and I think he'd be very effective in some capacity in a military national security sense, which is of course what he's done so well at, is one of the big picture thinkers within the military. He's in a unique category of military officers that are the classic soldier and scholar.
And you get the last word on this one. Thank you very much for
joining
us.
My pleasure, Richard. Thank you.
And that is all the time we have. I'm Richard Ager. We'll see you next time on New Hampshire Outlook.